Psalmist writes, those who trust the Lord are like Mount Zion. It cannot be shaken, it remains forever. Jerusalem, the mountains surround her, and the Lord surrounds his people, both now and forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing now just the first stanza. It's 521 stanza in the bulletin. It's number 569. Saviour, while my heart is tender, I would yield that heart to you. Service this morning, that's why I printed all the names of the tunes under the title, so I get a bit of a heads up on where, how to sing it. One of the things, one of the reasons we have a call to worship, why we read a portion of Holy Scripture, is to pay our minds off the things of this world, to cast our hearts and minds heavenward, to start to look at the Good Shepherd. And hopefully when I read to you from Psalm 125 verses 1 to 2, that softened your heart to sing the words we've just sung. We've turned our hearts and minds on things above. And so when we come to worship our Lord God, we come to give of ourselves as living sacrifices. We haven't come here this morning to get, but we've come to give of ourselves, our heart, our soul, our minds, all of us. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love. You have redeemed us by your grace. And your Holy Spirit now testifies with our spirit. And we are your children. The temple curtain is now torn in two. The blood of Jesus now speaks on our behalf, and by that shed blood we may enter into the holiest of all. Father, we stand before you bold and confident in Christ. Bold because we're clothed in his imputed righteousness. Bold in that we are certain, as we come to you in faith alone, that there is now no condemnation for us. Certain, there are nothing, but nothing, can separate us from your love. And this we pray and confess in Jesus' name. Amen. Our first hymn of praise this morning is number 156. Through the love of God our Saviour, all will be well.
Pray.
all actually well. For some reason in my mind and heart this week, I knew some people would be away. They told me last week that they'd be going away for a period of time. And so I was not expecting so many people to come this morning. But that's the father in my faith, isn't it? That the Lord does provide. And for those who listen with us this morning, I pray that today is a blessed time for you, a blessed time with the Lord Jesus Christ, and a blessed time as Christians in the one family of God. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we are creatures of habits. We are very comfortable in those things we are familiar with. We very readily adopt things as traditions. We feel safe in those things. And Lord, we are often taken by surprise. We rattle our cage. You show us that this is your church and you will provide regardless of our traditions and the things that we feel comfortable in. So Father, I praise you and I thank you for this day. I thank you that hearts have been touched by the Holy Spirit and feet have been moved to come to this place this morning. And Father, for those, there may be some who are probably not as willing or enthusiastic as others. Father, I ask the Lord Jesus would speak to them softly and tenderly. And they would get a glimpse of him and see the beauty of who he is and what he's done for us and what he continues to do for us. That he is attractive beyond all description. Father, we confess our sins, our transgressions and our iniquities. They are manifold. There is none of us who are without sin. Father, we confess that we can only stand before you because of the sinlessness of our Saviour Jesus, and that we are now covered, clothed in his perfect righteousness, but it's not a righteousness of ours that we have earned or inherited. Father, we confess that it is a free gift of grace unto us unmerited sinners. So Father, hear our prayer of confession. Lord, the times when we have been quick to speak and slow to listen, the time when we have presumed or assumed wrongly certain things, the times when we've lost control over our temper and we've spoken improper or harsh words to one another, the times, Lord, when we have decided we love this one but we won't love that one. Times, Lord, when we have glossed over what we would see as little indiscretions, harmless white sins. Father, we confess that we've also held desires in our hearts and those hidden recesses iniquities and desires. We're playing mind games in our own minds and born of the fruit of sin, which no one else can see, but you see them. Father, we confess all of those to you now, Lord, as each one here knows, but they need to lie at the foot of the cross and come on bended knee, so to speak, and confess their own individual sins, transgressions and iniquities. And I pray, Father, that you give each one of us confidence and trust to do that. That our faith is not just lip service, but is vibrant and living. And Father, I pray that as we pray our prayers of confession, that we would know that all our sins have been forgiven, that we are no longer under condemnation, that we have been adopted into your kingdom as co-heirs with our Saviour Jesus Christ. And these things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from Psalm 110. Psalm 110, starting at verse 1. My Bible, I'm reading from the Holman's Christian Bible this morning, and it comes under the title Priestly King.
Do you want me to read that?
No, it's right. No, I just need to get my vocal cords working again. The Lord God declared to my Lord, sit on my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord will extend your mighty scepter from Zion, rule over your surrounding enemies. Your people will volunteer on your day of battle in holy splendor from the womb of the dawn of the dew of your youth. Belongs to you. The Lord has sworn an oath and will not take it back. Forever you are a priest like Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will crush kings on the day of his anger. He will judge the nations, heaping up corpses. He will crush leaders over the entire world. And he will drink from the brook by the road. Therefore, he will lift up his head. Amen. It's a hard psalm to understand, especially when listening to it read by someone else. It's a convoluted psalm. In one moment, King David's talking about God the Father talking to God the Son and promising God the Son certain things. And then it's King David talking to God the Father about God the Son. And then when it closes up, it's King David talking on behalf of God to we who are his people. So it's some of the psalms are a bit tricky to understand. You've got to work out who's talking to who and what it means, but overall it's a great promise of a priestly king, of course, who's our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Let's worship our Lord God again. This time we'll sing number 171. What child is this, laid to rest in Mary's arms is sleeping? 171.
Thank you.
saying this here. For some of you who know me, it's, I have an annual rant each year about a certain activity the church does. At Christmas time, I wanted to sing this hymn, and I got to the third stanza, and I said, "They bring him incense, gold, and myrrh." Oh dear, oh, what's going to happen here? Broken my own golden rule of mentioning these things? So I went back and I did some research on the author, the man who wrote this hymn, to see where he stood theologically. And then I went back and read the scriptures that he got it from, and that certainly didn't refer to anything of wise men coming and bowing. And so I did my hermeneutic, I suppose, on the hymn, and I realised how encouraging this hymn really is. When we sing, bring him incense, gold and myrrh, we're not referring to the wise men coming and laying these gifts at the baby Jesus' feet. Those gifts represent all the best that you can have from birth to death. From birth to death. All the wealth, all of the best things that you could have in life. That's what they represent. The wealth of a good life. And so we're just saying there that we are to bring to him, that is Jesus, the very best of all we have. The very best that our life can offer up to him. And it says, not just us. He's also saying that to bring them to come peasant, the lowest of lowly people, kings come and confess that he is Lord over you, King of kings in your life, who's brought salvation and led your loving heart enthrone the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just on a Sunday morning, not just at Christmas time, but for every moment of your existence. So from my heart, from feeling crushed when I wanted to sing this hymn, I wanted you to sing this hymn, it suddenly soared like an eagle's wings. It's a great, that last stanza is a great personal confession of a genuine faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Oh, Father in heaven, Lord, we give thanks for this day. We give thanks, Father, for the railway engine blasting its horn. It reminds us of the gifts that you have given to humanity, that man could harness energy and use it for transportation. So just in little things, Lord, reminds us why we are so different from the beasts of the fields, why we are the apple of your eye, why we are the only ones out of all the created creatures that you breathe the nephesh into. So Father, we thank you and we praise you for that. And Father, I thank you for the souls that you have assembled in this place this morning, precious souls who have come and sacrificed their time, their energy, even their treasure to be in this place this morning. And Lord, I thank you for the gift of themselves and any gifts that they may feel moved to leave here. I thank you for them all. Father, I thank you for answering the prayers that we have had for so many folk we know who have struggled with compromised health. And we thank you that Ron Clements has returned home, and we pray that you would continue to strengthen him. I pray too that you would continue to uphold his wife Lynn as she ministers to her invalid husband at this time. Father, we pray for any who are struggling with issues of health at this moment, maybe suffering and pain. And I pray especially for those who are suffering at this time of the year, remembering the loss of a loved one. For those who Christmas forever reminds them of some tragic event in their own lives, I comfort them, touch their hearts, to they turn their eyes upon Jesus. I pray, Lord, for those who are struggling with loneliness, who won't be involved in family reunions this Christmas, who won't have people visiting them, won't share the joy that we have at this time of the year. Just amplifies the loneliness that they feel all year. Father, I pray too for those who have no sense of purpose in life. You find that they are of not much worth in their minds. You just want to be accepted. You just want to know that there is some purpose and direction for their existence. For those, Lord, I pray that you will touch their hearts and use us to introduce the gospel to them. And Father, I pray with thanksgiving for those people that you have raised up down through all the generations since Pentecost, who have led your church victorious through all that the world and the evil one would assault her with. And Father, I pray that you would raise up godly people, godly men to serve your church, and godly women to serve your church. And Father, most of all, raise up godly parents to raise their children, so their children know how to raise their children. Father, watch over those who can't be with us today. There are people travelling. I pray that you would keep them safe in every aspect of the word, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. And finally, Lord, I pray that wherever you have gathered your sheep in corporate worship this morning, they would be fed faithfully by the under shepherds that you have placed over them. And this I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.